तू शाहीन है, परवाज है काम तेरा, तेरे सामने आसमां और भी है।
स्वामी ने एक बात कही है ना कि ये मौत की बात थी, कोई किसी की बात ऐसे कर रहा था कि वो तो गया, चले गया, तो ये हंसने स्वामी हंसने से ऐसे नहीं कहते। जैसे देखेंगे ये बात, हम में से कोई एक जाएगा तो क्या हुआ फिर। स्वामी वॉज द फर्स्ट गाय टू गो आफ्टर अमंगस्ट दोस, एंड इट्स अ बिग गैप, लेट मी टेल यू, whether you like his painting or not. एक हस्ती थी, that हस्ती is so important, you know? And the हस्ती doesn't have like Mr. Modi to be flashed in the newspapers every day. Everybody who you come into contact with knows it, and that is the acid test of this thing. Does it work or does it not? Good sense, experience, and nobody has to lord it over कि मैं मेरे पास ये जादू है पुराने, ऐसी बात नहीं है। But एक you come to recognize a certain validity of things, you know. That's very important. It's very true. Actually, it's the value of truth that comes in there.
I recall the fact that he was an intellectual intervener on the art scene of India. I don't think anybody before him, perhaps Souza, but certainly nobody after him, has provided that kind of a scintillating intellectual articulation of a position. And he used to intervene. I think with his earlier Marxist and socialist background, he had turned to view art as superseding or exceeding history. And therefore he started painting that bird and rock, which can be of any time. So I think Swami was not bound by time. He was wanting to let his art soar in the timeless. And I think that was something very remarkable at that point of time.
Actually, my father used to say one thing that, the language of painting is very formal. It is also opaque. It is a language of qualitative cognition rather than analytical apprehension, which I find is quite appropriate for his kind of painting and my kind of painting, where one doesn't have to, the onlooker, the beholder should never try to see the meaning which the artist's meaning. He should try to put the meaning himself or herself into the painting.
Jagdish Swaminathan was born on 21st June 1928 in a wing of the Pleasant House in Sanjoli's Shimla, on a night when it rained incessantly. The image of Swaminathan that art lovers fondly remember today is that of a Tamil-speaking, Hindi-loving Baba or Swami with an excellent command over the English language as well. Attired in a white South Indian lungi and kurta and flaunting a beard and long hair, Swami truly conveyed the image of a carefree and bohemian Indian. Shimla was not only Swami's birthplace, a large part of his childhood was also spent there. He went to the Sir Harcourt Butler High School there, counting artist-writer Ram Kumar and his brother, Hindi writer Nirmal Verma, among his schoolmates. Indeed, Swami's friendship with Nirmal Verma has a long and profound history. During India's first general elections in 1951-52, Swaminathan was active with the Communist Party of India in Delhi and Punjab. Around this time, at a public meeting, he met Bhavani Pandey, a socialist comrade's sister, and married her in Lucknow in 1955. Swami was smitten by Bhavani at their first meeting itself, and once wrote, "In the gathering in front of me below the dais, I saw a face which was to transform my life and set me on the path of my destiny." Calm and serene, she sat listening like a classic yakshi, and I, on the wings of love, rose high above the dais and the crowd and the trees, beyond the sun and the moon and the stars. Swaminathan's disillusionment with the party also began around this time, and he finally broke away from it in the wake of the political developments in Hungary in 1956. Living in Delhi's Karolbagh area with two children, Kalidas and Harshvardhan, and wife Bhavani, Swaminathan had to struggle through life by taking up all manner of odd jobs relating to reading and writing. Noted cultural scholar Kalidas is currently director of the J. Swaminathan Foundation. Harshvardhan is a well-known and respected painter in his own right.
Earliest memory about my father is, he carrying me in his arms and walking around the veranda of our house in Karolbagh in the evening, trying to put me to sleep. And he used to sing a song, "Gagan Surya Ast Ho Gaya, Gagan Mast Ho Gaya." I don't know the rest of it. And then after that, when I grew up and started going to school and things like that, he used to be away most of the time during the day. And he would only come home quite late at night, about 10, and we were, asleep or something like that. We used to live with my grandparents. But in 68, when I was 10 years old, we shifted out of Karolbagh and took a house in South Extension, where the economical situation had improved, paintings were selling, and my father had also worked as a journalist in various journals and papers. And after shifting to South Extension, it was just our family, my father, mother, brother and I. So that was a little more intimate experience with him, and he used to make me stand in his studio, and I used to be his studio assistant and, tear rags for him and clean the brush and things like that. But after that, when I was 16, I went to Pilani for studies. Actually, when I finished my school, I came back, in those times I had something like 78% or 80%, which was considered one of the top percentages. That was in 74, I think. And KG Saab was sitting at home with my father. And KG Saab suggested ki Swami Harsha ko Baroda bhej do. So he asked me, and I said, "I don't want anything to do with art. I want to do something else."
All through his life, Swami was active at various levels in a variety of artistic and intellectual groups in Shimla, Delhi, Kolkata and Bhopal. Delhi Shilpi Chakra, Dhumimal Gallery, Triveni Kala Sangam, the Coffee House, Gadhi Studios and the platform in the Bharat Bhavan courtyard were inseparable parts of his life. In his initial years, he had a dreary political life, became associated with the Communist Party, was subsequently disillusioned with it, got into the trade union movement, sold cinema tickets in the black market outside Tiger Cinema in Kolkata for survival, even sold vests and underwear, and in his struggling years in Delhi, also penned a popular detective novel. He tried his hand at virtually everything. Swami was a compulsive reader and consequently had a deep understanding of ideologies, movements, and political and cultural battles worldwide. He was also keenly interested in anthropology. That's why he could follow the quintessential aspects of Adivasi life. As a painter, Swami possessed no degree in art. While working with the People's Publishing House in Delhi, he had joined the evening classes of the art department at Delhi Polytechnic, though it was not easy to study after a tiring day at work. In 1958, he went to the Academy of Fine Arts in Warsaw to study printmaking. It was a three-year scholarship, but he barely completed the first year and returned to India. In 1962, Swami formed Group 1890, a much debated group in its time. In those days, whenever he met his artist friends like Jairam Patel and Amba Das, there would be intense debates about theories of art. All modern artists looked in the direction of Paris, New York, or Mexico. Swami and his associates felt it was time to stop this nonsense. A number of artists, such as Rajesh Mehra, Ghulam Mohammad Sheikh, Jyoti Bhatt, Raghav Kaneria, and Himmat Shah, joined Group 1890. The house in Bhavnagar, Gujarat, where the artists in the group had their first meeting, was numbered 1890, and that's how the group found its name. The first and last exhibition of Group 1890 was held in Delhi. It was inaugurated by Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru, and its catalogue was written by Mexican poet and diplomat Octavio Paz.
The importance of the artist as an individual was pinpointed and focused upon by this group. Well, you know, the thing is that from the notion of a total objectivity to the notion of a total subjectivity, we found rather questionable. That there was the need to discover artistic expression as somewhere lying between the two, or rather the product, the end result of the interaction of the two.
According to artist Manjeet Bawa, in his later years for Swami personally, Group 1890 was little more than a page of history. At the time the group was formed, its concerns and the causes it espoused were certainly important. But according to Manjeet, compared to Group 1890, Bharat Bhavan in Bhopal was a far bigger achievement for Swami. The art criticism Swami published in Link and Contra 66 in the 1950s and 60s, and the provocative discussions that he launched, remain historically significant. The journal Contra 66, commonly referred to as only Contra, was founded and edited by Swami, who brought it out from Delhi in 1966 on the advice of Octavio Paz. It was run on the lines of the little magazine movement in India, prevalent in several Indian languages in the 1960s, and it featured poems, essays, and exhibition reviews. Each issue was accompanied by signed prints of Himmat Shah, Rajesh Mehra, and others. But it turned out to be a controversial magazine. Many eminent Delhi artists were alienated by Swami's contentious views, and it shut down after only four issues. Swami's association with the Dhumimal Gallery went back a long time. In those days, Dhumimal's management was in the hands of Vijay Kumar, known as Sethji, Mahendra Kumar, and Ravi Jain. Ravi Jain was the youngest among the three brothers, and his relationship with Swami was more amiable and professional. Poet and art critic Prayag Shukla's dedication for his Hindi book on Swami, published under one of Raza Foundation's special projects, reads, "Dedicated to the memory of Dhumimal Gallery director Ravi Jain, Swaminathan's collaborator, benefactor, supporter, and a connoisseur of art."
Swaminathan ji was a personality which has always left a tremendous influence in my life, because Swami ji at that time was almost like a pillar in the gallery. He had a very strong following. He sort of had a place for himself, both for us and the artist and the gallery. So So when you look back and see what Swamiji meant was a great feeling. And I learned a lot with people like Swami, Suza, Manubhai and these artists, Paramjit, and a whole lot of these people, because, I mean, as you know, Dhumiwal Gallery was like an adda for all the artists, and we all used to get together right from 2 o'clock onwards to 3, 4, 5, and my interaction with all these people, especially with Swamiji and his wife Bhavaniji, was a tremendous experience. I don't think one can learn anything like that, whether in a college or in an institution. What I learned from Swamiji and the whole community, art community, which was comprising of a whole lot of artists and the critics.
It was Ram Babu who had started the gallery out of his historic stationery shop in 1936. The kinship between Sailoz Mukherjee and Ram Babu is something of a legend. Swami too was highly impressed by Sailoz, having been under the spell of his image as a so-called mad artist since childhood. In the 1970s, Swami became Ravi Jain's main advisor. In those days, Dhumimal was the most talked about meeting point for artists. On Swami's advice, the gallery organized exhibitions of many of today's eminent artists: Bikash Bhattacharji, Krishan Khanna, Arpita Singh, Jogen Chaudhary, Manjeet Bawa, Amitav Das, Paramjit Singh and Manu Parekh, which lent both glamour and gravity to those times. In 1979, Dhumimal Gallery organized a solo show of Swami's works where all the leading Hindi poets of the day recited their works. On the occasion, Dhumimal also issued a 100-copy edition of Swami's Hindi poems with a silk screen design by Manjeet Bawa for its cover.
Purana Rishta Parvat ki dhar par baahein phailaye khada hai, jaise ek din badalon ke saath aakash mein ud jayega jangal. Kehte hain pehle kabhi koku naliye tak utre the ye devdar aur aasman ko le aaye the itne paas ki raat ko tare jugnu se गाँव में विचरते थे. अब तो बस जब मक्की तैयार होती है तब एक ससुरा रीझ पार से उतरता है, छापे मार की तरह बर्बादी मचाता है. अजी क्या तमंचे, क्या दुनाली बंदूक, सब फेल हो गए महाराज. बस अपने ढंग का एक ही बूढ़ा खुर्राट न जाने कहाँ रह गया इस साल.
जिस पर आकाश नहीं टिकता, जगदीश स्वामीनाथन के नए चित्र देखकर पीछे छूटा हुआ लौटता है, जैसे साथ ही था कभी छूटा नहीं था, पड़ोस से घूमकर वापस अपनी पर्ची में फिर. शब्द नहीं लौटते, लौटते हैं अक्षर, अपना विन्यास गवाकर प्राचीन लिपि अनंत की धूसर सतह के नीचे से चुपचाप झांकती है. प्रतीक्षा का गवाक्ष जिसके पार नहीं देखता कोई भूदृश्य, सिर्फ आकार, आभास, छायाएं, इस पर कोई आकाश नहीं टिकता, पर फिर भी जो बदलता है संभावना के गवाक्ष में. सरहद पर धुले पुछे से देव चिन्ह, रक्त तिलक, होने न होने की छापें, ये समय नहीं है जो कुछ पास है उसे नबेरने सहेजने का, याद करने का. ये सिर्फ जगह है जो बीत रहा है, जो बच रहा है, जो जगह बना रहा है उसके लिए. गलियारों, इतिहास के अरण्य रोदन, आशा निराशा के स्थापत्य के पार, ये सिर्फ जगह है, ये समय नहीं है.
In 1966, Dhumimal held a one-man show of Vivan Sundaram's works, for which Swami wrote the catalogue. In it, Swami said, "We all know that we had a glorious past. So glorious, in fact, that we are stinking with it. Only we are aware of our glory and not at all of our stink. I am happy that there are at least a few in this God-enthralled country who are young enough not to be taken in by the vials of the establishment. I am happy that Vivaan is one of them."
Very provocative show, and it was very different from Swaminathan's aesthetics, but yet he was open enough to open the show. Of course, there were people who were some of his colleagues, younger colleagues, who were surprised that given Swaminathan's ideas and his aesthetics, why did he open a show like mine? But he said he thought I was a good artist, and the matter ended there.
In the 1970s and 80s, two favorite artists of Ravi Jain of Dhoomimal Gallery, close to his heart, were Francis Newton Souza and Swami. But despite many similarities between the two, they belong to different worlds. Art critic Geeta Kapoor, in her 1978 book, Contemporary Indian Artists, writes, "Like Souza, he, Swaminathan, had also the facility with words. While he groped his way through his images, he backed them up with persuasive arguments. Swaminathan was able to add a kind of political perspective that Souza, despite his temporary politicization, never seemed to have gained. Unlike Souza, Swaminathan was not an admirer of Picasso. In fact, he once said that Picasso's art means nothing to me. He was a bull in the china shop of art." Souza found this comment by Swaminathan highly provocative. He believed Picasso and Cubism opened a large window to modern art. Nevertheless, the two artists had a strange sort of love-hate relationship. In one of his paintings, Souza even depicted Swaminathan as Christ among a group of artists.
So I believe that Swaminathan and Ravi Jain made the best artist-dealer partnership that we've had in the Indian art community. There have been others with Vadera and Hussain, or with Sakshi Gallery and Manjeet Bawa. There have been other, or Kali Pandol and Hussain Saab. But I do believe that between Ravi Jain and Swaminathan, it was the most productive and the most active partnership that we've had in Indian art history. Between both of them, not only did they control most of the Delhi art scene, but it was also to do with things like poetry, to do with things like other forms of art. There were regular poetry sessions at the gallery. There were regular meetings between artists, critics, collectors. So it had become a sort of a meeting place during Swamiji's and Raviji's time, where all artists would gather. There would be interaction. Artists would be designing each other's catalogs. There would be discussions as to which younger artists need to be promoted and which should be shown, and not only in Delhi but across India, whether it be Vivaan Sundaram, whether it be Bikash Bhattacharji. There were a lot of important exhibitions that were done during that period. So as a child, one would meet Swami uncle very often. He was a regular visitor to the gallery. So my interactions with him, of course, were more as a child to this thing. One thing, of course, vividly I remember is that his painting colors, I always found resemble these balloons that we used to get very often. So as a kid, I still remember when we would be playing with these balloons, I would always identify the yellows and the oranges with his paintings. Then if I would ever be painting in the gallery, once he'd ask me what was I painting, and I said the one who's laughing is a Sukhi Aadmi and the one who's looking down is a Dukhi Aadmi. So it said that you must continue this, and he'd also told my mother to preserve these drawings so it will be a good archive to look back on.
Bharat Bhavan Bhopal has a multi-arts complex which was inaugurated by Mrs. Indira Gandhi on 13th February 1982. Rupankar Museum of Fine Arts, a constituent unit of Bharat Bhavan, has two wings, one for the moderns and the other for folk and Adivasi art, where works in its permanent collection are on display. According to poet and critic Ashok Vajpayee, while establishing and directing the Rupankar Art Museum at Bharat Bhavan, Swami redefined the contemporary in a radical manner, wherein city dwellers alone were not contemporary, but the folk and Adivasi artists were also considered contemporary to the same degree.
Bharat Bhavan as a building was designed by Charles Scoria, but as an institution, it was a making of a trio. Jagdish Swaminathan, the theatre man B.V. Karanth, and me. And Swami's role was very crucial, almost central, because Swami brought a new concept of contemporaneity to Bharat Bhavan. Till then, the popular notion of the contemporary was that it was urban, modern. It did not take into account the folk and tribal art at all. Swami tried to redefine the contemporary by making it simultaneous with not only the urban, but also the rural, the folk, and the tribal. This was a path-making direction which Bharat Bhavan took under him. The second point that makes Bharat Bhavan special was that this was an institutional intervention at a time when almost all public institutions in this country were under some kind of a decline. And therefore, a public institution of all the arts together was again an innovation and a daring. And Swami was very much part of it, because Swami, besides being a painter, an intellectual painter, an ideologue in some sense, was also very deeply interested in poetry, in music, in other things. The third point about Swami's contribution was that he involved young art students to collect folk and tribal art. This was a double-edged thing. One, that they will go into interior parts of Madhya Pradesh, into jungles of Satpura and Bastar and what you have, and will have the first time an encounter with folk and tribal art traditions. Two, they will bring whatever they discover to Bharat Bhavan. So Bharat Bhavan had at that time more than 1,000 tribal and folk artworks, which constituted the main collection of Rupankar, the museum as we called it. Earlier, it was thought that they should be mixed up. Then it was thought that it would create some kind of a confusion. Therefore, the urban modern art should be in one section, but an equally important and almost of the same dimension would be the other section where folk and tribal art would be displayed. This is how it happened.
His life and art were so closely enmeshed that one cannot be understood without the other. In the beginning, Swami wanted Rupankar to display the contemporary as well as the folk and Adivasi artists in the same section. But some of the eminent modern artists opposed the idea. In the introduction to the catalogue titled The Perceiving Fingers, published in 1987, Swami writes, "A plan for the collection was drawn and students from the state-run art institutions were asked to volunteer for the collection drive. We were taking a bath of humanity every day. We were irrigated by the cultures of our peoples and we were reborn. A live contact was established with hundreds of folk and Adivasi artists during the drive, which has now ripened into an ongoing relationship."
Actually, Jangad Singh Shyam was discovered by Swami when he was on his way to Patangar, which was the place where warrior Alvin had once upon a time lived. And Jangad Singh Shyam was a young boy breaking stones on a roadside. Swami stopped, asked him whether he knew Patangar. And he said, I belong to Patangar. So he said, why don't you come and take us there? On the way, he started talking to Jangad Singh and asked him whether there was any painting in his village. And he said, we all paint our hutments, inside walls, etc. So that's the beginning. And then finally, when the visit ended, Jangad Singh was persuaded by Swami to come to Bharat Bhavan. And that's how he came to Bharat Bhavan, where he was given new material, new colors, canvas and paper, which he had never seen in his life. And it was his genius that he took to them so spontaneously, so easily, so smoothly, and became, in fact, a painter of great consequence. It is also an example how a singing tradition was converted into a visual tradition.
हमारे लिए तो स्वामीनाथन एक भगवान है और एक हमारे लिए एक पूरा हमारी जिंदगी लाइफ बनाने वाले इंसान था वो.
Perceiving Finger, the book that Swami wrote, had a very deep link with the museum, Rupankar. And in fact, they are byproducts of each other. That the museum led to the book, but the book contains the basic preamble of the museum. And the basic insight behind that is a very radical one. And it is to say that the technological developments in different societies do not make them more developed or less developed. Inside the history or outside the history, that's a wrong way of looking at the development of human beings or the historical time. So he, in a sense, was trying to say that you may have a very developed technology, but if you have a very poor artistic tradition, then you have no right to be called more developed culture. So therefore he said that this whole idea of the developed human being that the European person considered himself to be and the less developed human beings that the tribes were considered to be, this has no basis, because the earth moves in infinity and infinity does not have a progression. So this idea is completely idiosyncratic. It's a made-up idea to finally create the superiority of the Western mind and Western man.
So when we talk about Swaminathan and Bharat Bhavan in connection to tribal art, paintings and sculptures in tribal communities, and if you look at his vision, he was the only artist who saw this tribal art not as a tribal art but a contemporary art, and he thought that this is an expression of men, and which is important. If you look at Picasso, he also used the tribal art for himself. Swami was the one who never used tribal art for himself. He brought them in the picture.
In 1986, Jagdish Swaminathan, assisted by sculptor Robin David, created a work titled Minar-e-Shaheen in Bhopal, in memory of the great Urdu poet Allama Iqbal. Famous for tiny, poetically rendered birds in his works of the 1970s, Swami, for once, chose to create a giant falcon, or Shaheen, to depict the Urdu poet's spirit of fearlessness, uncompromising will to fight the forces of darkness, and indomitable thirst for freedom. The great Indian painter M.F. Hussain inaugurated the ambitious project in 1986 and also made a drawing on the subject. Created in the wake of the 1984 Bhopal gas tragedy, the sculpture is a grim work of art and a warning to multinationals, about which Swaminathan once said, "It is not supposed to look beautiful." Swami was a great admirer of Urdu poetry and through Shaheen paid homage to Iqbal, recalling his lines, "Your nest need not be on the royal castle's dome. A royal falcon that you are, make rugged mountains your home." Eminent Hindi writer Krishna Baldev Ved wrote, "Much as Shaheen is flying, it is also perched. All the flying birds have subsumed in Shaheen, and all the mountains in the rock on which Shaheen is perched, seemingly flying."
Now, in the same, the very beautiful, sculpture and the monument that he made close to, inside the Iqbal Maidan, in the old city. And he chose Shaheen to be the symbol of Iqbal for the memorial of the Iqbal. And Shaheen is a very strange bird. It's a bird which flies very fast, and in Iqbal it represents what he called a Kamil human being, which means a complete human being. By that, of course, he meant a complete human being is a Muslim, but if you break the Muslim, also is somebody a deeply ethical person, because Muslim is who has Mukammal Iman. So which would mean that somebody who is a very ethical, deeply ethical person is a Mukammal human being, is a total human, complete human being. And that has a very distinct quality, that it lives, Shaheen lives in the world, amongst the people, amongst the other birds, and yet it soars slightly above all of them. So above would mean that slightly indifferent to one's life, to the life around the Shaheen. It is part of it, and yet it is to an extent indifferent to that. And I think that's very important to understand this monument, because Shaheen, at the top of that, of the monument, is a stone, almost like the stone which, as if it has come from one of the paintings of Swami, and that's on the monument, and on the top of it is Shaheen taking a parvat.
Swami had a large number of admirers, but many of the leading artists didn't always agree with his art or his radical ideas about art. However, his extraordinary intellectual authority certainly left the art world astonished.
I prefer the old days when we had no money. We fought, I don't like Swaminathan. But there were occasions we had exchange of words and exchange of good words also. He may occasionally say something good about you. Who be hai? But there was always a very vital kind of interaction between artists. Swaminathan never liked my work. And maybe to some extent, I also didn't like his work. So, our dislike was reciprocal. So that is one thing. Second thing, I think Swaminathan is a man of very strong views. I think in a way, I'm not aggressive, I'm also a man of very strong views. The conflict happened in 2-3 times. For example, Rivierma exhibition.
I like Swaminathan, I tell you. Art philosopher, he is a very sensitive person, all through I have seen. But he wanted to show how our art could be different, But many places, I like many of his work, but not all of his work. Swaminathan's works are, it is indicating, it is an example of works, how work should be different from following the Western art of, arts. See, that is what he wants to say. He wants that it should be different. That is we can find from his work.
but all works may not be great.
Krishna Baldev Ved has written about Swami in his own inimitable style. Driven to desperation by the heat of the high noon and my own restlessness, I land up in the company of a close friend in those days at that Karol Bagh room where it is rumored that Swami sometimes works on something. Maybe we have shown up there to prove the rumors wrong. It's a bare room where Swami stands half naked, like some young beggar famishing for many days. His sleepy and lost eyes emanate an opaque iridescence, somewhat in the manner of the nearly mad paintings of his final phase. On the naked floor, a virgin canvas is turning and twisting. Swami is staring at it and is possibly cleaning his same knife with the same rag which was subsequently immortalized by Octavio Paz in one of his dramatic poems.
With a rag and a knife against the ID fixe, the bull of fear, against the canvas and the void, the uprushing spring, blue flame of cobalt, burnt amber, greens fresh from the sea, mines indigo, with a rag and a knife, no brushes, with the insomnia, the rage, the sun, against the black face of the world, true crushing spring, serpentine undulation, the aquatic vibration of space, the triangle, the arconum, the arrow stuck on the black altar, the angry alphabet, the drop of ink of blood of honey, with a rag and a knife, the uprushing spring, springs the Mexican red, turns black, the Indian red springs, turns black, the lips go back, the black of Kali, charcoal for your eyelids, woman desired every night, the black of Kali, the yellow and its searched beast, the ochre and its underground drums, the green body of the black jungle, the blue body of Kali, the sex of Godelpoop, with a rag and a knife against the triangle, the eye burst, fountains of signs, the serpentine undulation moves, wave upon wave of imminent apparitions, the canvas, a body dressed in its own naked enigma.